Thank you. The next item of business is a statement by Patrick Harvey on heat in buildings consultation. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, and hence there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Patrick Harvey. Up to 10 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The climate crisis is, of course, the greatest challenge of our age. And Scotland has halved our emissions since 1990. But the most challenging part of the journey lies ahead. That's why the First Minister and the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero will be at COP28 this week to share our experience and to learn from others on how we secure a future for both people and planet. We've got a legal obligation to make this journey, to which all parties in Parliament signed up, but this is not just because the law says we must, and it's not just because floods and fires show us we have to act. And it's not even just because of the huge economic opportunity for Scotland, an opportunity that we've set out as one of this government's three defining missions, but fundamentally because it's in the interest of the people this Parliament represents. And that's true in the way that we heat our homes and buildings, and the opportunity to free people from dependence on fossil fuels and the volatile prices which drive fuel poverty, and to free the world from reliance on the brutal and authoritarian regimes which control so much of the global fossil fuel market. That's why I'm publishing today consultations on proposals which, if Parliament approves, will give the leadership and clarity Scotland needs to make the transition to clean heat by 2045. I've had the great fortune in this job to see firsthand the countless examples of that heat transition already underway. A retired man telling me about how clean heating had transformed the comfort of the suburban bungalow that he and his late wife had shared for decades. A family in Lochaber amazed at the reduction in their bills after moving from LPG heating to a heat pump. New homes being built to a zero emission standard from Shetland to the centre of Edinburgh by developers choosing to act well ahead of our new build heat standard, which comes into force next April. A visit to a heat pump manufacturer in Glasgow, investing in the new jobs and skills that Scotland needs. Listening to how Argyll Community Housing Association already has more than a quarter of its 5,000 homes using heat pumps. One of many social landlords leading the way and doing so in some of Scotland's most rural settings. And just yesterday, visiting the new heat network in Edinburgh's waterfront, one of a rapidly growing number of heat networks here in Scotland. Presiding Officer, the move to clean heating is not just for tomorrow, it's already here today. Our role and a responsibility which all parties in Parliament share is to give the certainty and long-term time horizon that accelerates that growing trend. It'll give households the information they need to plan and give businesses the confidence to invest. We do that by providing the most generous package of financial support in any of the UK nations. And just last week, I welcomed the first report of the Green Heat Finance Task Force, outlining the enormous appetite from private funders to support that work as well. We do this in stark contrast to a UK government which seems more interested in exploiting climate as a political dividing line than in rising to the challenge, and a Prime Minister whose climate U-turns in September may have a bigger direct impact in England, but whose signals have a profound impact on what consumers hear and what businesses need throughout the UK. And today, we take this forward by setting out a clear framework of regulation which takes us from now through to 2045, working with the gradient of consumer demand and industry capacity. Firstly, to tackle fuel poverty, reduce energy bills and increase home comfort, we intend to regulate to ensure that Scotland's homes meet minimum energy standards. Privately rented homes to meet a minimum energy efficiency standard no later than 2028, owner-occupied homes to meet the same minimum energy efficiency standard by 2033, and a new net zero standard for homes in the social rented sector, comprising a new and higher energy efficiency standard between 2033 and 2040, and all homes moving to clean heat by 2045. Secondly, I want to help heat networks grow to meet their full potential of up to a third of heat demand. There are currently more than 1,000 heat networks in Scotland, but many are small. That's why we're consulting on new powers to safeguard those locations and circumstances where heat networks are most attractive, and to ensure that heat networks are viable in those places. Thirdly, we're consulting on all homes and non-domestic buildings ending their use of polluting heating by 2045, with staging posts along the way to avoid a bottleneck as we approach that deadline. If agreed, in the first instance, people buying a home or non-domestic property before 2045 would end their use of polluting heating systems within a specific and reasonable period following that purchase, with a set of exemptions and abeyances to reflect different circumstances. Fourthly, in order to demonstrate public leadership, we intend to set an earlier target of 2038 for all public buildings to have clean heat. Presiding Officer, I want to turn now to address the issues of timing, scale and pace. I've already confirmed that the key dates in our 2021 heat and building strategy remain in place. 2028 for minimum energy standards for private rented homes, 2033 for minimum energy standards for other private homes, 2038 for public buildings to be zero carbon, and 2045 for all buildings to be zero carbon. I can also set out our intention to have, by 2025, the main legislative foundation in place for the heat transition. But as I've worked through stakeholder feedback, detailed evidence, and the very significant changes in the cost pressures facing households and businesses over the last 2 years, I can now set out a more detailed timescale for the current decade. If by 2025 Parliament approves the bill that I intend to bring forward, that will require detailed secondary legislation, and that will take us into the next Parliament before those regulations have an impact. This means that it might be 2028 at the earliest before the first home or building owners are required to act under the terms of those regulations in order to ensure that we're fair, just and proportionate. That timeline, in turn, has two implications. First, the position that we set out in our 2021 strategy of starting the heat transition at different times in off-gas and on-gas areas, 2025 and 2030 respectively, is no longer our intended approach. A single timeline taking effect from 2028 is fairer and clearer. We'll still be taking account of the different contexts in urban and rural areas, but through our delivery programmes, our funding and our use of exemptions rather than primary legislation. Secondly, our intention for clean heat to play the maximum possible role in our 2030 climate plans would have meant more than 1 million homes decarbonising by 2030. The single timeline that I've now set out from 2028 means that scale of change is not achievable by that date, and more of the transition to clean heat shifts into the early 2030s instead. That approach allows us to gain the full benefits of the technological innovation that's already taking place to build the workforce capacity, consumer demand, and economies of scale that we'll need. The timeline I'm outlining today sees Scotland on by far the most ambitious path within the UK, with the deployment of clean heating systems at scale and pace very much faster than the prevailing take-up rate. Coupled with our pioneering work on the new build heat standard, on standards for social housing, on energy efficiency, driving the development of heat networks into the next decade and beyond, and to repeat, providing the most generous package of funding support in the UK, it's clear that Scotland can have the most ambitious zero carbon programme for buildings ever seen in the UK. Presiding Officer, I know that there are some people in this chamber and beyond who regard clean heating merely as the latest front in a climate culture war. They can expect to be disappointed. The days of heating our homes and buildings with fossil fuel and polluting systems are numbered. But during this consultation, I intend to take an open and constructive approach with any MSP and any party choosing to take this issue seriously. Not just political parties, but a wide range of stakeholders, from businesses investing in clean heat to fuel poverty campaigners, from private landlords to funders. Bring forward positive ideas and I will listen. This consultation and our final proposal will be shaped by those views. But for those who wish to pretend that the heat transition isn't necessary, or who want to treat this as a shallow political game, or those who trade in vague promises with nothing to back them up, they will not only be abandoning the commitments they made when they voted for the climate targets, not only betraying the clear majority of the public who want ambitious climate action, they would also be undermining Scotland as we seek the maximum social, environmental and economic opportunity from this ambitious transition. and that would serve no one. So today is the next big step in meeting our climate ambitions and embracing a warmer and cleaner future. Let's all rise to that challenge.
Thank you, Minister. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which time we will move on to the next item of business. And it would be helpful if those members who would wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak buttons, and I call Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank the Minister for advance sight of his statement as well. For homeowners in Scotland, today will mark the start of a 10-year time bomb for over half of Scotland's homeowners. Yeah. SNP and Green ministers have come to the Chamber today with a timescale, but not a plan on how they will achieve what they are set out. And there is absolutely nothing in the statement today to provide reassurances that SNP and Green ministers actually understand the true costs that will face homeowners the length and breadth of Scotland. Yeah. Estimates have suggested that a rural property, for example, may cost over £30,000 to achieve the minimum energy efficiency standards. So can I ask the Minister, what estimation of the costs of compliance for the average home has actually been undertaken?
Minister.
Well, to be honest, I'm not entirely sure if Miles Briggs thinks that giving 10 years' notice of this coming in is in some way bad for homeowners. I think it's really important that we give people clarity to plan and businesses clarity and timescale to invest. That long-term time horizon is what will drive up investment in skills, in capacity and in innovation. He should also be aware that the first report from the Green Heat Finance Task Force published last week begins to set out some of the innovation that's happening, for example, in financial products, green mortgages and other forms of driving more investment. In terms of the assessment of the overall cost, this will vary significantly throughout the country and in different building types. That's why part of the consultation is looking at the issue of abeyances and exemptions to look at different circumstances. But I hope that Miles Briggs and his party colleagues will come to recognise not only that this heat transition is necessary, but that investing in it and giving people a long-term time horizon to plan for it is going to maximise the economic benefits to Scotland and the cost-saving benefits to households in the long run.
Sarah Boyack.
Can I thank the Minister for advance sight of his statement and draw members' attention to my register of interests? Timescales for action are already slipping since the first heat and building strategy was published. Why is it taking 2 years, as people need to have homes now that are affordable to heat and power? We've been told £33 billion is needed from that strategy, so where's the money coming from? Minister, people don't need warm words, they need warm homes, and they need Scottish Government leadership. So given that the failure to spend £133 million on retrofitting last year, what lessons have been learned so that people don't get ripped off when they try to do the right thing?
Minister.
Well, I think it's really important that we take account not only of the cost of living pressures that many people have been facing in the last couple of years, and that is one of the reasons why we have to adapt our plans to cope with what people can realistically afford, but also look through the implications of the UK government climbed down on climate a couple of months ago. Some of the direct impacts from Rishi Sunak's bizarre speech announcing the scrapping of climate action, some of those direct impacts will be felt more significantly in England. But on investment, we already see the UK slipping down the league table of green investment, and that will have an impact if we don't counter that narrative here. So it's really important that as investors look across Europe and the wider world at where they want to put their money investing in net zero, we need to send a crystal clear signal that Scotland is serious about getting this job done, and Scotland is serious about making sure that this is an attractive place for that investment to come to make this possible. In terms of the commitments that we've already made, Sarah Boyack is aware that we've committed £1.8 billion over the course of this Parliament. Over a billion of that has already been committed through the budget process as we're at the halfway point in this Parliament, and we'll continue to build on that strong track record.
I call Marie McNair to be followed by Douglas Lumsden. Ms McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Queen's Quay, in my constituency, where my office is located, has the first 100% carbon-free district heating system in the UK. It heats council buildings, West College Scotland, Clybank Leisure Centre and a new care home. And this is a great innovative example of delivery of carbon-free energy. Can the Minister advise what emphasis will be put on the expansion of this and other major heat network projects to help deliver more green energy to homes and businesses?
Minister.
Mary McNair is absolutely right to draw attention to this. It's an excellent example, not just at a technical level, about how heat networks can provide affordable, reliable, decarbonised heat, but also at an economic level, where leadership by the local authority is making sure that we get the maximum social benefit of developing that. Now, we've already worked with our colleagues in Denmark. We've already passed, in the last session of Parliament, heat network legislation. Just last week, I brought a target to the Parliament for the amount of heat that we expect to see delivered through heat networks by 2035. Almost all political parties actually managed to bring themselves to support that target. That's the kind of signal that we need to give to ensure that local authorities, social landlords and other organisations see the delivery of heat networks, decarbonising existing networks and the expansion of new ones as a huge opportunity for them to meet this, this heat transition in a way that works for their local community.
I call Douglas Lumsden to be followed by Ivan McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Minister what punishment there will be for homeowners who fail to carry out the required work after the purchase of a property from 2033? The consultation seems to suggest civil penalties or building societies and banks getting involved. So can the Minister guarantee us that homeowners will never be punished or even evicted by their building society for non-compliance?
Minister.
Well, I think I would encourage Mr. Lumsden to read the detail of the consultation documents that we've published today, and also, I'm not sure if he wants to hear the response.
Minister, please resume. See, we need to hear the person who has the floor. In this instance, it's the Minister. Minister, please resume.
I would encourage Mr. Lumsden and all members to read the detail of what we've published today, as well as reading the Green Heat Finance Task Force, which some, I think, in the media have picked up on, you know, individual lines that relate to things like council tax. The vast bulk of what they have written in the task force report and of what we've written in the documents we're consulting on is about support, is about incentives, it's about making this system work for people. We have looked at the option of civil penalties in relation to landlords who fail their tenants by not investing in bringing them up to standard. We've not suggested that there would be, at least in the foreseeable future, a role for civil penalties in relation to homeowners. But once again, the balance of the benefit of this heat transition will be achieved if we place far more emphasis on support and incentives rather than amplifying people's fears by using words like punishment.
Ivan McKee to be followed by Roger Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Domestic heat pumps and other technologies powered by electricity, while very welcome, will require significant upgrades to the electricity grid, particularly alongside the rollout of EV charging points. So can I ask what detailed analysis the Scottish Government has done to ensure grid capacity will be in place to support the delivery of its heat and building strategy in the targeted timeframes, and is this analysis in the public domain?
Minister.
We do obviously engage with the network operators as well as with Ofgem on this. Ivan McKee is quite right that the application of electrification, both to heat and to transport, does have implications in terms of grid upgrades. It also offers opportunities because as we see more storage, either in terms of vehicles or domestic energy storage with heat or electricity, it actually gives us the opportunity for the energy providers to use smart tariffs to ensure that we're getting the maximum benefit from low-cost renewables when those are coming onto the grid in large volumes, and then people can use that energy when they need it. So there are advantages from this issue, not just challenges in terms of grid upgrades. But we engage actively, as I say, with the network operators and with Ofgem. We believe that there is capacity in the system to continue to develop in line with the trajectory that we're taking on heat decarbonisation. But I'm sure this is something that the committee will continue to take an active interest in the, not only the months but the years ahead.
Rhoda Grant, followed by Kevin Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The statement says nothing at all about how we reduce the amount of heat we need. My constituents suffer the highest levels of fuel poverty in Scotland due to living in old, drafty and poorly insulated homes. There's nothing at all in this statement about insulation and how we tackle the fabric of our buildings. Can I ask when he's going to address that fundamental question?
Minister.
Well, I'm sorry that Rhoda Grant gets that impression. I did address the issues of energy efficiency standards in both the private rented and in the owner-occupied sector in my speech. And the detail in the consultation documents will go into that as well. The work that we've done prior to this current consultation on the issue of EPC reform also addresses how we give people the information that they need to invest in their homes in order to reduce energy demand. And the work that we've done to extend the Fabric First measures, the energy efficiency only measures in the social rented sector, is also important. That was an ask from the social rented sector to extend the funding for that, that type of investment, and we've responded positively to it.
Kevin Stewart to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Hydrogen will play a vital role in Scotland's future net zero economy and could and should play a part in heating our homes as we move forward. Can the Minister please outline what engagement he has had with the UK government, academics, energy companies and industry leaders to ensure that Scotland fulfils its hydrogen potential?
Minister.
Scotland does have immense potential in the production of green hydrogen and the application of that to decarbonising many aspects of our economy. I think there's an emerging consensus that that will play a very significant role in some parts of our transport system, in industry, in a number of sectors. But I think there's an expectation that it will not play a central role in home heating. In order to generate renewable electricity, convert it into hydrogen, transport the hydrogen, convert it back into power that can be applied in heating, we'll always have efficiency losses at every stage of the way. So using that renewable electricity directly, especially with devices like heat pumps that achieve so much more than 100% efficiency by drawing energy from the ambient environment, will have far greater benefit. I think the UK government is also moving now to a position that we took some time ago of recognising that hydrogen may have some role to play in heating, but it's not expected to be a central one. We do, of course, continue to engage with all stakeholders interested in the green hydrogen economy in the wider sense, and we in no way play down or seek to ignore the immense opportunity that hydrogen will have for our economy and for the rest of our energy system and industrial uses.
Liam MacArthur, to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you. Can I start by noting my interest as someone in receipt of both FITS and RHI? As the First Minister jets off to Dubai for COP28, his government is downgrading its plans to decarbonise buildings. What was a clear mission to get 1 million homes onto climate-friendly heating by 2030 has now gone. So can I ask, in relation to the first hurdle in 2028 of getting private rented homes up to minimum standards, what will the Minister do differently, given that the only government support scheme for the sector has upgraded just 215 properties in 3 years?
Minister.
Well, the reality, of course, is that as a result of the decisions that I've announced today, Scotland will have by far and away the most ambitious programme of heat decarbonisation of any part of the UK. This is a very sharp contrast with the announcements of the UK government in scrapping important measures on energy efficiency. They obviously announced that they were scrapping some non-existent policies as well, in a bit of a kind of pantomime bit of rhetoric, but they scrapped really significant policies on heat decarbonisation as well. This government is taking absolutely the opposite approach, of taking an approach which is achievable, affordable, but also ambitious, and making sure that we offer the most generous package of grants and loans to householders in Scotland to ensure that that's achievable.
I call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Denmark is a European leader in district heating, as recognised by the Scottish Government when it signed a memorandum of understanding on the green energy transition with the Danish Government in 2021. How is Scotland sharing best practice with our neighbours as we expand our heat network ambitions, a key part of the heat and building strategy?
Minister.
Yeah, we've engaged actively with colleagues from Denmark who I think advised the government in the last session of Parliament on the shaping and framing of the heat networks legislation. I've also had the opportunity to visit and see the continued expansion of heat networks. I think it's really important to recognise that Denmark is a country which has had 50 years' experience in building modern heat networks, which now cover something like two-thirds of households in Denmark. We don't have 50 years to wait to decarbonise our homes. We need to act faster. So heat networks will play an important role. So will individual systems such as heat pumps. But we'll continue to be informed by our European partners, including those who are already installing clean heating systems at a significantly faster rate now than they have been in previous years. Those are lessons that we need to learn, and we need to show that Scotland is going to gain the greatest possible economic benefit from joining that rapid heat transition.
Graeme Simpson to be followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, if we force people living in tenements to pay potentially ruinous amounts of money, that could be a breach of human rights. And that's why we set up the Tenement Maintenance Working Group in the last session. It's why this whole area of law reform now sits with the Scottish Law Commission. Does the Minister not agree that if he wants to make the sweeping changes that he does want to make, that it should be done in conjunction with the work that the Scottish Law Commission is undertaking?
Minister.
Absolutely, I do. And we've also been working with the Tenement Short Life Working Group. I had a meeting with the Chair just last week to talk about their recommendations. I've said before, and I'll say again, when we frame, as a result of the consultation and the views that we'll hear in this consultation, as we frame some of the exemptions and abeyances, I don't think anyone will be under any surprise that traditional tenements may well take significantly longer than the rest of the housing stock, and very many of them will be the ones that need to benefit from heat networks rather than individual flat-by-flat heating systems. We're absolutely going to work with the grain of the technology development that's taking place, absolutely going to work with the grain of the recommendations that come from the Short Life Working Group, and as a tenement dweller myself, I understand the challenges, but I know that people, including my constituents, and I imagine Mr Simpson's constituents as well, want the solutions, and that's what this government is determined to give them.
Mark Ruskell to be followed by Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you. I really welcome the clarity with which the Minister has set out the pathway to 2045, and I also welcome the stark contrast of our trajectory with the UK government, because the Prime Minister's decision to scrap minimum energy efficiency standards for private landlords will cost tenants in England £8 billion over the next decade in higher bills. So can the Minister confirm that private landlords in Scotland will be required to meet minimum energy efficiency standards, and can he outline what the benefit is going to be as a result to Scotland's 300,000 private tenants?
Minister.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I think I've been very clear in the statement about the 2028 target that we intend to bring forward on minimum energy efficiency standards for the private rented sector. Mark Ruskell rightly talks about the cumulative impact across the whole UK of the UK government's decision to scrap that policy. But just thinking about the household by household impact, some £300 a year, some £300 a year added to the bills of PRS households because of that decision by the UK government to scrap their policy. We won't impose those additional costs on people. And if the UK government was remotely serious about making the transition to net zero affordable, what they'd have done is break the link between electricity and gas prices rather than adding even more to the energy bills of people in the PRS. That's not the approach Scotland will take.
And Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Much of the discussion about heating in the future has been around heat pumps, but in a lot of situations it seems that district heat networks or communal heating systems are better suited. Does the Minister agree that heat networks should be a bigger part of the picture, and if so, what actions is the Scottish Government taking around this?
Minister.
Yeah, absolutely. There will be places where individual household by household or building by building solutions are going to be right, but there will be many parts of Scotland where district heat networks and communal systems across large multi-occupancy buildings will be the right way to go. As I said earlier, we've learned a great deal from the experience of our colleagues in Denmark. Last week, we took forward the secondary legislation to set the 2035 heat target of 7 terawatt hours of heat through heat networks to Parliament, and that was agreed. And the range of support that we have from the heat network support unit, sharing the skills and expertise to bring projects forward. The Heat Network Fund to invest both in pre-capital and capital support that's needed to bring those networks to fruition, and working with a wide range of institutional investors who see this as a great place to put their money. I would far rather that all of our collective pension funds, for example, were invested in the kind of technology that we need in Scotland, like heat networks, rather than in some of the industries that are making this problem worse.
And Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What does the Minister have to say to people whose homes cannot physically be retrofitted? And last year, 1,464 photovoltaic devices were installed with loans of £7.25 million from the Scottish Government. This scheme has now been scrapped unless combined with a renewable heating system, which not everyone can afford. Surely half a loaf is better than no bread, and people should not be discouraged from installing solar panels, given their positive impact on climate change.
Minister.
We certainly don't discourage people from installing solar, far from it. And in fact, no funding for solar was scrapped. The same funding is available. We need to maximise the heat decarbonisation potential of that funding, and that's why we changed some of the rules around how people access that funding. Just recently, though, the Scottish Government published a tenfold ambition for expanding the deployment of solar in Scotland. It does have huge potential, not just to add renewable energy onto our grid, but actually to make sure that householders, businesses and communities are generating some income for themselves in order to reinvest in the built environment. And I'm just seeing, Presiding Officer, the first response from the Chief Executive of the Climate Change Committee has responded to our proposal, saying that these are bold proposals to decarbonise Scotland's buildings, and they recognise the importance of a long-term plan with a welcome focus on upgrading properties at the point of sale. So I very much hope that that spirit of cooperation and constructive engagement is going to characterise our political debate on this issue over the coming months.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the statement, and there will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.